I'm really delighted to be here today with so many human rights defenders from around the world. More than anyone else, you make a difference on the ground and make positive contributions to people's life. You have my respect, my support, my gratitude for the individual sacrifices you are making. And we have seen many examples when we heard our friend from Bahrain and what he has to live. When we have seen the faces of so many people still in jail because of the fight they have been doing. We have been seeing women that has been, and I've been remembering some of my meetings. I remember a meeting with young students and journalists that have been freed from Nicaragua not so long ago. And one of the girls, a medical student, she was a Nicaraguan Swiss citizen. So the Swiss government pushed the Nicaraguan government to free them. And she said the same that a friend from Saudi Arabia said. She said, I'm not going to be released until all my colleagues are released. So I think that spirit of fight on one hand, solidarity on other, and respect for themselves and for the other is something that really is so important and shows the quality of the human rights defenders. As this gathering reminds us, we are more than a collection of individuals. We are a collective force for the defense and promotion of human rights in an age of unprecedented global challenges. We have seen pictures of people demonstrating, asking or demanding climate action because climate change is a real threat for human rights and for humanity. Deforestation, populism, food and water security, the globalization and increasing automation of industry, the unprecedented movement of people, and many more. It has never been more important to uphold and advance people's human rights. In the past few months, we have seen people in many parts of the world, including Hong Kong, Russia, Indonesia, and Papua, Indian administered Kashmir, Honduras, and Zimbabwe, just to name a few, taking to the street to ask for something fundamentally human, to have the right to participate in decisions about their lives and their futures, to demand that their human rights are respected. And there are some good stories. Last week in the General Assembly, we had a meeting with the new government of Sudan, and they were in the streets demanding for human rights, demanding for people's rights, social, economic, political, civil rights, cultural rights. And now they're in a process, and a transition like every transition has a lot of challenges. We don't know what will come afterwards. But they, when they enshrine the Constitution, they said that in the Constitution it should be enshrined human rights. So at least it's a good start. And let's hope that continues that way. And we will give, as an office, all the support. So people have been there demanding the human rights to be respected, as always. And our role as human rights defenders in this process is to act as a sort of conduit, amplifying the voices of those at risk of not being heard, raising sometimes difficult issues, defending those who others seek to silence. So this role is crucial, but it's not always welcomed. Obstacles are created by states and others. Civil society groups face curbs on funding and complex registration rules. Human rights defenders increasingly face online abuse and harassment, disinformation, and smear campaigns. Criminal justice systems are misused to target legitimate groups and individuals. Those who kill, attack, and harass, whether on behalf of state or other groups, may go unpunished. And public discourse against human rights is on the rise. We're really living on a pushback on human rights and women's rights. Do you know, in November we'll have in Nairobi, Cairo plus 25. And next year it will be Beijing plus 25. And really the discussion right now is trying not to move forward because that's impossible. It's just not to go backwards. So that's the kind of situation we're living today in the world. So that's why you are so needed. Human rights defenders are so needed because we need to push back the pushback on human rights. So I was saying that public discourse, and you see people saying things that in the past were impossible to hear. Even some states are adopting narratives that are hostile to human rights and human rights defenders. Minorities are vilified and targeted. I was saying that women's rights face pushbacks and resistance to progress. Friends and colleagues, at times the scale of our worldwide and individual challenge can look overwhelming. We know that tides in international affairs ebb and flow. How can we anchor ourselves to the bedrock of international human rights law and international humanitarian law in the face of a rising tide of worldwide challenges and populism? Firstly, it is essential that we rebuild the global consensus around the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and I am absolutely committed to using my mandate to help achieve this. Last night we were discussing, one of the ministers was mentioning that maybe it would be interesting here in Ireland, for example, to include a program at schools about human rights, so children will know what their human rights are, because sometimes they take it for granted and they don't know all the human rights and how they can defend that. So how can we reach other constituencies, if I may say, other people and youth to be part of the human rights defenders? So we must never allow the narrative to take hold that civil society participation is valueless or, worse, dangerous. The Minister of Foreign Affairs mentioned that sometimes for government, civil society can be complicated because they tell you what you don't want to hear sometimes, or sometimes you disagree. But the truth is that it's so important, the participation of civil society, on to make decisions better sustained with the concerns and the needs of the people who are there on the ground. So we will never accept a narrative that says that participation of civil society is not valuable or dangerous. But civil society participation is the lifeblood of any healthy democracy and society. I have been in government, but I was in civil society as well. I was during the dictatorship in a human rights organization who we care for the child of the missing people. I mean, I'm a pediatrician of the missing people, of people who have been victims of enforced disappearance or extrajudicial killings or in exile or internally displaced. And really, it's so important that we can build this whole participation where people can be part of the building and construction of a society. And if you here today, we'll have examples of it in action, from indigenous community to mega cities. There is no one place on earth so remote that people's human rights cannot be threatened, and there are no cities so vast that its people cease to be of significance or autonomous bearers of human rights. In all these places, people will always seek ways to improve their lives and futures. This is a basic human desire. You know, when we work on human rights, we receive a lot of different arguments why human rights are not important. Some people tells you, some state members tells you, you know, this is a sovereign issue, you should not intervene. Some other people use this as an excuse, and probably many of the ones who have been in prison are charged with extremism, terrorism. Of course, there's excuses. And we say to them, yes, security is a very important issue, but we can do it in compliance with human rights laws and with humanitarian laws. So we always feel that people need to improve lives, and will always be people like you that will be there to ensure that people can improve their lives. And it's therefore critical for us to push states to honor their obligations to protect all human rights defenders and civic space, to insist that they take their duties as states seriously, and to call them out when they fall to do so. When civil society channels flow freely, it means vibrant debate, freedom of thought and opinion, and public engagement in policy. It means healthy democracies, benefits for the economy, and improved social protection. It means better health services, education, housing, and water and food security. When debate is stifled and opposition voices are silenced, it means increasing repression, growing tension, and the risk of explosive rage. It means the truth is suppressed and populism thrives. The UN founding principles make clear that civil society is not an optional extra for states. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights grants people's rights not only to do things that states like, but also things they might dislike. I was also want to mention that when some member states say that human rights are not universal, they say that they are Western. But to tell you the truth, all of us who know about it know that the commissioners were from all over the world. The commissioners who developed this Universal Declaration, they were from, of course, from some Western country, but also from Asia, from Latin America, and from, I don't know if, at that time there were not too many African countries who were independent, so probably we might not have had. But let me tell you that there was a woman, an Indian woman, a feminist Indian woman, member of the commission, who developed the idea of all human beings. Because at that time, people were used to talk, following the French, les droits de l'homme, the rights of the men. And that was what was going to be written there. And these women said, no, 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 if you put that, state will use it against women's rights. So that's why the Universal Declaration speaks about all human beings. And that, I think, it's a very important thing because it's a contribution of a woman, but an Indian one, because otherwise we would be still talking about men's rights. So I think it's a very, very important thing to say. It's not Western, it's universal, to have the right to education and to have the right to speak and to be able to participate among many other human rights. So I think that people are free to hold opinions that are different from those of the government. They're free to mobilize other people for legitimate purposes and to protest against political decisions. These are neither crimes nor terrorism. They're basic human rights. Friends and colleagues, alongside this vital work of rebuilding consensus, I secondly want to highlight two other ways that we can positively promote human rights and the work of human rights defenders, and that is connection and communication. One of the things I've asked myself, in this difficult context that we're working, what can we do better? And one of the things we were discussing last night is we're still working in silos. Environmental activists work on environmental issues. LGBTI communities work on LGBTI issues. Women's rights defenders talk on women's rights. Indigenous people on that. And maybe we need to get more together to reach out other constituencies, to build bigger platforms so our voices can be heard with a stronger voice. Because we, for us, all are human rights. If one cares about climate change, should care about LGBTI rights as well, or women's rights as well, indigenous rights as well, because they're all talking about human rights, of the possibility to be who we are, to live how we want to be, to love who we want to love. So we're always trying to think, what else can we do? Because we're in a really bad moment for human rights. So I hope that in this discussion, during this day, you will come probably with very important proposals that can help us build together a better moment for human rights. I'm not trying to be, I have to say though, that even though tactically I'm not so optimistic, strategically I'm very optimistic. So it is a bad moment, but I'm sure, first of all, we're not gonna give up. And second, I'm sure we can overcome this moment and create many positive possibilities for the future. So our generation of human rights defenders has unique ways to connect and communicate by using online spaces. Social media has democratized the sharing of information. It's true, though, that has been misused as well for hate speech and other issues. We know, for example, in the Myanmar situation was hate speech through social media that triggered violence. And we're working with companies to see how can we do so artificial intelligence, digital space, can be for good, can provide better opportunities for the world and not misuse and target human rights defenders as it has been done in some parts of the world. So we can build networks of human rights defenders within countries and regions and create global support for particular issues. And I'm sure that the Frontline Defenders Platform is one of the objectives is that exactly, to build this network, to know that you're not alone, that you have a lot of other colleagues and friends that are there for you as well. We can speak more directly to political leaders also through all these ways. We can highlight challenges and celebrate success. We can back each other more effectively in cases of attack. We can tell our stories to wider audiences. Anywhere that online spaces are available and not deliberately restricted by governments, we're no longer dependent on mainstream media or communications campaign to shine a spotlight on human rights abuses and violations. Our power to build consensus is directly linked to our ability to connect and communicate, both with each other and with the wider public. As part of this, we need to develop our work at the level of ideas. We can create a vision that shows people the world we would like to see, where human rights defenders can work safely and reach out to encourage people to stand up against violations. A world where people understand that human rights are everyone's business and are prepared to stand up for them. Friends and colleagues, I hope we can all be part of this shared work to build consensus, connect, and communicate. As we break this down country by country, issue by issue, we can test the human rights health of state with two sets of key questions. The first relates to collective space. Do states recognize that participation and freedom of expression and association are rights? Do they create space for people to voice their views and influence decisions about their lives and futures? Do they establish channels for people to contribute to society, to have an opinion, and to express their views peacefully? Do they ensure that a free and widely accessible internet enables critical debate and a battle of ideas? The second relates to respect for people operating in that collective space. Do states acknowledge and respect the vital role of human rights defenders? Do they celebrate them and their contributions? Do they provide protection? Do they monitor the situation and address any issues that arise? And states' track records in these two areas tell us so much, because human rights exist in dynamic societies, not static spaces. For every new protection mechanism or law, a new setback is created. Alongside the familiar attacks on human rights defenders, we now see intrusive surveillance tools, online disinformation campaigns, the blocking of accounts and websites, even the wholesale shutdown of the internet. And these difficulties are exacerbated when it comes to women, religious or ethnic minorities, migrants, or LGBTI or indigenous defenders. So it is essential that we use consensus building, connection, and communication to recreate a virtuous cycle in which the enjoyment of human rights leads to better societies, which leads in turn to fuller enjoyment of human rights, which then feedbacks into better societies. But it's also not only about government. And I'm just going to mention very shortly, because I've gotten too long, I'm Latin American, so I'm sorry. We are working also with businesses. Business to include and integrate women with the same opportunities as men, but also from a couple of years on inclusion of also the rights of LGBTI communities. At first, they did not realize that there were people from the LGBTI community working in their companies, that they were not free to express themselves as they were, and they don't even were aware that LGBTI communities' rights are human rights. So we work with them. The office develops standards on inclusion, and now we are working with some companies who really have gotten into this very important banner, and they are trying to mentor and reach out to other companies to protect, to promote that LGBTI communities as well have all the adequate labor work, I would say, place at the workplace, at the marketplace, everywhere, all the rights. So there's lots of things, and you can get very good allies. You can get people who, on one hand, they promote human rights, they are pro the Agenda 2030, but they also can identify either specific areas where they can push, like women's rights or, in this case, LGBTI rights. So I'm finishing to say that all this work of consensus building, reaching out wider public, pushing together on the human rights has to be done at the global and the grassroots level. Neither is complete without the other. So friends and colleagues, we don't yet know how the world will emerge from its current period of unprecedented challenges. And he didn't say it, but the Minister of Foreign Affairs has to deal with Brexit issues today. That's one of the challenges that they are leaving here. So we don't know what will happen. We know we'll do our best and we'll continue pushing for a better world for everyone where human rights are respected. But as you mentioned Toni Morrison, and I will mention, but not fortunately the same quote, as the late, because it happens sometimes when we speak about Mandela, we all use the same quotes, huh? Because we have the same heroes. Huh? Well, as the late American writer Toni Morrison expressed in 2015, I will quote her, "I know the world is bruised and bleeding, and though it is important not to ignore its pain, it is also critical to refuse to succumb to its malevolence." End of quote. So that means, I will say easily, we're not going to give up anyway. So some of us here today may have ourselves being left bruised and bleeding in the name of human rights. Some have comforted the bruised and bleeding, while others have highlighted their stories. But what we must not do is give in and fall silent. So for all that, thank you so much for what you do every day.